Continuing our look now at the best in children's television. This morning, the new kid, or dinosaur on the block.
So the big purple reptile that kids can't resist.
The big purple dinosaur.
Teaches about love, and it just kind of like soothes the kids.
And always, there's that signature song.
Welcome to the inaugural very first episode of Purple Tales podcast. I'm Nancy J, and your host is none other than Carey Stinson, who for more than 20 years was the man, the person inside the purple suit. Carey, what do you feel when you hear those three notes?
Love. Love. Such an amazing, that song and everything that it stood for.
You have tears back, in your eyes.
It brings back all these incredible stories and memories.
So why are you just now deciding to really share these incredible stories and memories?
Couple reasons. One, I have found over the years that when people do find out what I used to do, they're interested and they have stories. They came to a show, they watched the TV, their kid loved it. And second of all, we're losing some of the people that used to be with the show. And I think it's important for us to be able to get these amazing stories out and these amazing people that were involved with the show.
I think anytime you mention Barney, it just makes you feel good.
Yes.
Wouldn't you say so?
Absolutely.
But how did you come to be in this podcast? Why was it? Was there somebody that like said, "Hey, Carey, you need to be telling your story"?
There was a very good friend of mine who we'd known each other over a year, and I got a text one night and said, "Were you Barney?" I was like, "Yeah."
You know what?
I was.
I tell you what, it's funny because you and this friend of yours mm-hmm. are the ones who have created Barney and the Purple Tales podcast.
Yes.
So I think, and he's kind of our boss
yes.
on this podcast.
Yes.
So if you don't mind, Chris Kraft, can you get in here?
And, I'm supposed to be behind the scenes, guys. Sorry.
Oh.
I'm just joking.
No, come on. But it's amazing. You and Carey were friends and you had no idea that he had anything to do with Barney.
No, not at all. I kind of knew Carey as a photographer. So that's how we connected. We did, I think, an art show actually together.
We did.
And we cruised around the back roads of Texas, thousands of miles. And one day I was at home with our beautiful granddaughter and we're trying to keep her entertained in her little pack and play. And we decided that we would switch to some kids programming. And she would have none of it. She didn't like it. Whatever 0 to 3 programmers put on Netflix was just not her thing. And we threw a Hail Mary pass and said, "Is Barney streaming anywhere?" And because our kids grew up on Barney. And we put it on. And from those first three notes that we started this podcast with, she was hooked. We literally binge watched with a 2-year-old. Probably 3 or 4 episodes, and it was on one of those episodes that we saw the credits rolling, and I saw Carey's name, and I'm like, "Stop, put it on pause." I took a screenshot, I texted it to him, and I'm like, "Dude, were you Barney?" I literally still have the text, "Dude, were you Barney?" And those three little dots that appear when people are hesitating to respond showed up, and he said, and I could tell reluctantly, "Yes, that was me for 22 years. And that was just like, wow. So that from that moment on, I knew him for over a year. And from that moment on, I was really urging him because, you know, I didn't want to be a fanboy with this new knowledge. But my kids grew up on Barney. And so I would be teasing these stories out of him on these long road trips where we're doing pictures. And they were amazing. I'm like, "You got to get these stories out. You have to tell these stories." And for a lot of reasons, which we'll probably cover, he was reluctant to do that. And with a lot of urging and nudging and pushing, we're here today doing the first episode.
Well, thank you for that nudging and pushing. So, Chris, get back to work. You've got to be our boss. Make sure everything goes well here on this first podcast.
Yes.
So what was your feeling when you realized here's this friend and now you're going to have to kind of come clean?
I love it. I really do. And I've never run from it. I'm very proud of it. very proud of it. Just, you know, becoming a photographer and going in that direction has been my focus. But I love hearing the stories, and it brings back so many wonderful memories.
Do you feel like you're just kind of stripped down a little bit now? I mean, you know, this is,
sure,
we're unveiling,
right,
your face. People, right, are going to see you now.
Yeah. Yes, it is a little different. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Absolutely.
Well, so through the years, did you make a lot of good friends? I mean, has everyone kind of dispersed?
No, we still are connected. You know, it's such an amazing, the show and all aspects of Barney, not just the TV show, but the tour and everyone involved with it, loved it so much and were so passionate about it. And so we were all very close. We spent a lot of time together, and I can't even tell you how excited I'm about who we have here.
Whoa. Who do we have here today?
So this is one of my brother in arms. We did the show together for years, but I knew him, I'm over 25 years.
Okay. So
and someone else will be unveiling his face as well.
Oh, okay. Who might that be?
That would be Jeff Ayers.
Ah, and welcome.
Baby Bop.
Hi. Hello.
Hello. You know what? To me, I mean, I remember covering this story, Barney, when Barney first started being a news reporter, television reporter in Texas, and when this was based here and everything was happening, I was reporting on this, but the two names, the two characters were Barney and Baby Bop. Y'all are probably the most famous, wouldn't you say?
Yes.
Yes, well, Barney obviously was the first character, and then Baby Bop was number two that they brought on.
Okay.
And you start, what year did you start, Jeff?
93.
And how was your, how did you audition? How did you find out about it?
Well, that's a story. First of all, I used to be a mascot. And I used to mascot in high school, mascot in college, and also I worked for NCA teaching mascots all over the country and doing cheerleading camps. And so I wanted to be a professional mascot after I got out of college. And knocked on the door of the Mavericks, the Cowboys, and kind of presented a plan to them. Got in touch with the Ted, the San Diego Chicken, and he hooked me up. He hooked me up with the Chicago Bulls, and that deal fell through. And all of a sudden, I was working at a gig several years later. And I got a call from my agent, Peggy Taylor, and she wanted me to go audition for this character on Barney. And it was one of the body puppets.
And did you know what Barney was at the time?
I never watched Barney in my life.
What do you mean by body puppet?
The dinosaurs were classified as body puppets.
Yeah, so there's two people involved in each of the dinosaurs, a voice and then someone inside.
You weren't the voice?
I was not the voice. The voice. So, yes. So each of us, yeah, he was in the costume as well.
It takes two people to run the outfit, basically.
Yes.
Okay. So the audition.
Okay. And so I watched one of the videos to kind of do my homework, and I didn't have a clue that it was going to be Baby Bop. But I watched Barney and Baby Bop, and I said, okay, I can do this. it's one of the body puppets, and... So I show up at KD Studios and walk in the door, and there's a room full of girls in ballet outfits.
But isn't that Baby Bop? Isn't Baby Bop a girl?
Yes, but I didn't know that it was for a ballerina, basically. And so I show up, and I'm going, I think I'm in the wrong place. And so the casting director came and said, no, it's for a body puppet. It's for a costume. They just... dressed up like the character. And I said, well, I didn't bring my tutu. So, you know, what I do? And she goes, don't worry, you know. And so they had the call, and we went through the room, and I showed up in the room, and they asked me to be shy, asked to be sad, emotions. And those emotions is what I used to teach all my mascots at NCA camp. And so the bigger the emotions, the bigger expressions you make. And so I had them rolling because of my face expressions. And then they wanted me to put the suit on. And Baby Bop was 5'7 at the time. And so I'm about
the original.
The original Baby Bop was 5'7. So they had the suit there, and they put the suit on me, rolled everything up, and put the head on me, and bam, the lights went on. And I knew right then that I think I got it, because I lit them up. And that wasn't for sure, but I felt really good about my audition. And then the rest was history, so.
Wow. I mean, so you took the place of a 5'7 Baby Bop.
Yeah, they wanted to make Baby Bop smaller, because their ultimate goal is to bring in a character which was Baby Bop's brother. Baby Bop's brother was older than Baby Bop, so it would be hard to bring Baby BJ, you know, up against Baby Bop. And so they needed somebody in between the costumes.
You're gonna have to make me a family tree.
Well, I also know they also did it because the kids could relate to it. Barney was so big that for a little one, it's intimidating, and they could go right to Baby Bop.
And that right there was very neat, because we'd do meet and greets at different locations and stuff like that. We do concerts and stuff like that. They yeah. always do meet and greets. And whenever we do a meet and greet, Barney was like 10 feet tall, you know.
Or
something like that. He was not, he was, you know, on TV, he's only, you know, small.
Right.
But when you see the kids run up to Barney and all of a sudden put the brakes on and then scream bloody murder, and all of a sudden Baby Bop's there. Oh, let's just go to Baby Bop. And they should have made it the Baby Bop show. But you know.
Well, you never yeah. know. You yeah. never know. That could still happen, perhaps. So do you remember meeting each other? Because you were already Baby Bop for a while before you came on, or how did, what was
so
your
So when I started, I actually started before the TV show. So I started doing birthday parties. They had done three videos at that point.
What year?
So this was 91 when I started.
Okay.
And when it got on the TV show, they shut down birthday parties for legal reasons, as you can imagine. And they needed a second person, because all of a sudden it was blowing up. So a gentleman named David Joyner was doing the show at the time, and that's who Jeff worked with for years. And then I was doing PR. And then I toured, and then Jeff and I actually did the TV show together years later. Yeah. But on the PR, we would go on the road together doing sing-alongs.
And that was really neat, because they had these 20-minute sing-alongs, and it was a couple of songs that we did. And we knew that we had something going on, because we did a little tour down the East Coast, and we were packing stadiums. And I got a photo of the back of the stadium, and all it is strollers. And it's a whole parking lot full of strollers. And we didn't know how big it was, because we were sitting there filming on TV until we got out and saw it, the effect. From all
but
the
I
people.
Had been seeing that,
and he's been seeing.
Because I had been on the road, so I did promotional tours for JCPenney's originally. That's when I got originally hired for them, and the first one that I showed up, it was in Mesquite,
Texas.
In Mesquite, Texas, mm-hmm. yes. And the whole concept that was with Barney would be in the store, in the JCPenney store, and then kids could meet Barney, and it had all the Barney store to it. And the first night, so many people showed up that they destroyed the store. They rushed to get to Barney and knocked down everything. So they started a new policy that no one went to Barney. Barney went to them, because we just had so many people in time-wise. So I'm on the weekend seeing 10,000, 15, 25,000. But they're in Allen shooting in this little studio, not seeing how popular the show was becoming.
Again, Allen, Texas.
Allen, Texas.
Yes.
I mean, kind of small town for North Texas, and this amazing idea came out.
Yeah. Well, and Jeff, that tell them about the studio in Allen, the first studio that you...
Yeah, the studio was there off of Bethany in Allen. It's a small studio that we'd shoot from one angle, and we'd be in the school, and then turn around and shoot from... We'd back all the cameras up and then shoot from... the playground back into the school. So it was a very small studio, and then we moved on to Los Colinas.
And this was before the internet. This was before
yes.
any, so how did you get all of these fans? How did that work out?
It's all love and all the hard work and all that type of stuff. Plus, you know, him going out on the road and doing the small concerts and, appearances and getting the word out. And I know that that it worked out very well because, you know, PBS was wanting to change things and they didn't want it to change.
Yeah, they got videos in Blockbuster originally as well.
Maybe we should explain to some of our viewers and listeners what Blockbuster was.
Yeah, it was a video store.
And if you had the visual, you'd see the single tier.
Yeah, the single tier. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So yes.
Yes,
so
they were back. Yes, okay. When it was Blockbuster Video
VHS.
Was around. VHS. Mm-hmm. And they actually, it's very brilliant. Cheryl Leach, who created the show, went to Blockbuster to get them in all of their stores, corporate, and they turned her down. So she got together a network of mothers that went to the individual stores and got those videos in the stores. And Larry Rifkin, who was up in Connecticut, public television, his daughter rented one of those videos and he saw the reaction. And that's how he ended up getting the show. And as Jeff said, the show actually got canceled.
It was almost being canceled. It wasn't officially canceled, but it was heading that way. And I think it was the year that I came on, they were thinking about maybe, you know, taking it off. But all the babysitters and all the moms and,
yes,
and the dads, they didn't protest it, but they raised a ruckus and they realized that it was very important what we were doing. And it was very educational. And then, you know, one of the other things that, that was out there was educational books. You know, the books that were done, Carey and I, you know, did photography and was shooting books. And I gotta tell a story about, we were shooting, Barney goes to the grocery store. And we did a couple of grocery stores in the area. And we couldn't do it during the day because the mobs, so we shot at night. And we shot it late at night, like at midnight through 5 o'clock.
Local grocery stores all over Dallas.
The neatest thing was after we get through, we'd head to our trailer, you know, in our suits and head to the trailer. And one little girl came walking around the corner and ran right smack into me. She about eye level with me. And she went, "Baby Bop shops at this store." And so it's about 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock in the morning. So I think we've ruined her life because she'll want to go shopping at 4 o'clock in the morning from now on. And
looking for Baby Bop.
No one asked why she was there at 4 in the morning.
She was with her nanny or mom or somebody.
Wow.
And she had her blankie and, you know, they were getting something. So, but that's, you know, that's one of our other stories is
Little girl is listening, if she remembers running into you, please let us know. Contact us. We will put you in touch, yes, with Jeff. My gosh, when did you realize this was a big deal? Was there a moment kind of that aha, like, yeah, you know what? This is huge.
I know when for me, so I'll be interested.
You know,
when for you. I think it might be the same moment.
To see it on TV and seeing the work. And, you know, I say the work. The work was, you know, thousands of people that were in part of our family.
Yes.
And that went from the grip to the lights to the Wranglers to everybody that's a part of it. It was something special. And how it was working, I didn't have a clue how it was going to go. But how we touched all these people, even the school teachers that worked with us, you know, the people that did the script and making sure it was educational. Cheryl, Kathy, Dennis, all the producers, you know, and the list goes on. And then you go into the books, all the publishing, all the team that was on the publishing team, special events, you know, it was a big machine, a big family that got it working.
But we were all local.
To Texas.
We were all local to Texas.
So when was your moment?
Well, it's gotta be Radio City Music,
yeah, and I agree.
In 1994, so they took us up to New York, and we did I think it was 12 shows.
It was 12 shows, Barney Live at Radio City.
Sold out in.
That was it. I think that was 30
minutes,
for me
something
too.
Something of that nature.
I think that was it for me too. The reality is, I am stepping on a stage. I'm stepping in the middle of the stage that all these performers have performed on, and it was a blessing, you know. except the elephant. So
wait, whoa, whoa, what elephant? Were there live elephants?
We had a
live elephant.
We had
a
live elephant on our on Barney Live, so it was pretty interesting.
Messy, well, perhaps?
No, I think what he's referring to is so this is a massive production. We had dancers local in New York, and then all our crew, and kids, and massive production. And so we're sitting in our dressing area, and all of a sudden we hear, we got to get away. Yeah, in our ears, the elephant's gotten loose.
No way.
And this is before the show, wasn't
it? This is just a rehearsal.
Oh, okay. Because I couldn't remember if it was during one of the shows, like before
the
show.
No, it was a rehearsal.
It was a rehearsal, like a live rehearsal or something.
But the elephant's loose backstage, and you'll hear us, and throughout this whole podcast, you'll hear this a lot. We'll say Barney Magic. We all believe in Barney Magic. The elephant didn't destroy one thing.
It went straight to its spot. It went to the X on the floor where he was supposed to go.
Barney Magic. Barney, I am writing that down. Yeah. Absolutely. So you had all of these kids and parents in the audience after the show. Did they storm the stage or what? Did you ever get to really interact with the kids at Radio City Music Hall?
You know, there's a pit there, so that kind of prevented them from coming up on board. But I kind of flash forward a little bit. When we were doing these little road shows, we performed at Ryman Auditorium. Is it Ryman?
Nashville.
And we performed there. Well, their stage had light bulbs all the way across the stage.
Well, it was the original.
We were at the Grand Ole Opry.
Performing, and that's the other real moment, because I'm stepping going, I can't believe this. I remember stepping out there when I was a little kid, when I was 3 years old, watching Slim Pickens, all these pit bull on this stage, which was really cool. But back to the concert thing that we did, after the concert was over with, the parents would put the kids up there and push them towards Barney, and here's Barney, huge as big, really, really, really big, and here comes the little kid. So we had to, be very careful. But when they were stepping on stage, they broke all those light bulbs that went all the way around the stage. So that was another moment.
Yes.
So, so you traveled all over the world together on these shows?
When I came in, we did basically in the U.S. and Canada. And then they took off all over the place.
So what did you put down on your passport as your profession?
I said professional crossdresser. No, just kidding. It was an actor.
Okay,
an actor.
So you considered yourself an actor during all,
yes.
I mean, of course. And
yes.
What was on yours, Carey?
I just went with actor.
Okay, that too. Did you consider yourself actors?
I think probably, I always looked at myself more as a performer.
A performer.
I was a musician before I got the Barney job, so I didn't know how to dance. I don't know if you, did you learn to dance on the show, or did you?
I have two left feet, so I was a three-year-old dancer, so yes.
But yeah, I had to learn a lot of that throughout this whole.
Yeah, I mean, we had a performance director. We had to learn dance, and but we had to get the suit moving too. So
yes.
That's a good question. The suit, what was involved in that, Jeff? Were you able to just like zip yourself up and there you go, and Barney just puts his head on and that's it?
Well, that was kind of. I got in the suit from the back, the kind of the side or the underneath it, and they put the head on me, but it was a pretty good size. You picture it wearing kind of like a snowmobile outfit and having to dance and sing and run around like crazy in a snowmobile outfit. So
Jeff and I learned very early on the responsibility. Barney was and Baby Bop were so real and so important to these kids. This was their friends. So I wasn't Carey anymore when I got in the costume. He wasn't Jeff. We were those characters, and we knew whether it was TV or in Nashville or wherever we were, the importance of that. And that's why our relationship, I think, is so strong over all these years, because we had to rely on each other. When we were doing scenes, if we were on the road, all of it, it worked because we were on the same page. We were helping each other.
And that even goes back to the voices.
You know, absolutely.
Without the voices, I wouldn't be what I was. We synced up together.
How did you sync up together?
It took a while for me to do it because being a boy and a girl and having to make sure that I was a 3-year-old and not, you know, 18, 20-year-old dancing. I needed to be a 3-year-old, all giddy and happy and la, 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 you know, basically. But it was really learning the script and being able to understand my voice. And it was very scary because after a while, we clicked. And we really synced up together. And she knew kind of where I was going.
But you were never on the stage at the same time.
No. She was in my ear.
Oh boy, same thing.
Yeah,
with Barney,
so
right?
they would have 4 monitors. So they would sit with a mic and 4 monitors and a script, and so they're watching us. We had a rehearsal week, just like a typical TV show would have. So except the difference is, so on a Friday they would be in a script reading, and we would be in choreography. So we'd be learning the moves, and they'd be learning the script. And then Monday we would work together and go through the whole script, go through everything. So everyone had a general idea of what we were gonna do. And if I was gonna do a jump or a hop or a skip, we could talk that out so they would have a general idea of what was gonna go on. And I think we each—
And they wouldn't make sure that Barney, they were clear of Barney, because Barney is huge. And they would whop him out. If he did his jump, he'd clear us if we were anywhere around him. So he goes, I'm going to do my jump right here. And I'm going, okay, I'll make sure I'm out of your way. And you know, we knew what we were doing. We had to block ourselves.
Yes.
And make sure we kind of stick to it a little bit.
I was going to say, what if you did it wrong?
Well, I do it wrong all the time. So.
Well, you got knocked over.
You got knocked over.
You got knocked over.
And we had a lot of collisions and a lot of bloopers on the set.
Injuries?
No,
at all?
I don't think we, I don't think. Yeah, Carey might have, but
maybe a couple.
Yeah, there might have
just
been
just in
some.
Case my mom's listening. I don't know.
We'll talk about that later. We'll get to that eventually. What was it like, though, after those shows? You take off the suit, and I mean, were you just drained? Were you tired? Did you want to go out on the town? What, I mean, because you could. Nobody knew who you were,
no.
So you could do all sorts of things.
Yeah. And that was a blessing, because
yes.
You don't have stalkers or, you know, all that type of stuff. You know, one thing that I'm so blessed with was the wranglers, the people that was our dressers, and they would help us get in and out the suits, because they were the first person to put us in and the first person to get us out. And so they had to, you know, where our electrolytes were gone, we were drained.
Yes. Okay.
And so we might be a little angry or a little stressed or whatever, and they were the first ones to see us. So after pulling the suit off of us, it's like, here's your drink, here's your towel, smile.
They took amazing care of us.
Yes.
They would, each of them would be, they'd be just watching us to make sure. And I mean, it might be my energy's low and they'd give me a cracker. So, I mean, it was whatever.
A cracker. Let's make sure we get a cracker.
But it was other items.
but whatever
bars,
it may be.
Energy bars.
And Gatorade or water, yeah. Or towels, yeah. Or...
Oh, and they tried everything for us, and tried to make it work. And
sure,
they wanted us to stay in there as long as possible with us happy. And you know, and that was the main thing. Those Wranglers were probably the key to the pie, because they kept us, you know, going. They doctored us. They fixed things, anything that was broken. And so they're one of our special people that
probably the least appreciated. I mean, we'll have to find some of those Wranglers.
Yes, we
still
not a problem, because they're very good friends. Very good friends. They understood, just like we all did, how important this is. They understood the importance of Barney. They understood how the kids loved. You know, we would do make a wish. You know, so you'll have a child that's terminal that would come on. Well, everyone's there. The directors and the Wrangler, so everyone would see how important this was to children. and to the parents. So everyone in these productions just was full of love and understanding the importance. This wasn't just a 9-to-5 job. This was something very important that we were doing.
And that's what I'm hearing talking to you, is this was almost a mission. This was an important part of these kids' lives, their parents, and a big responsibility.
Yes.
You know, that's, you know, I didn't get to do all the make-a-wish because they kept it small. They wanted it to be more of a moment with Barney. And most of the time we were there at the hospital, mm-hmm. Or different places like that. There's one person that asked me if we did, you know, meet and greets. And I said, well, we don't really do meet and greets. He goes, well, I've got a friend that's got a kid that's got cancer. I said, okay, tell me about it. And he goes, well, he's wanted to do a make-a-wish, but they don't know it. I said, okay, give me his number. And I hooked it up with Special Events, and they brought him on the set. And we all melted because it was his last, you know, maybe last week. And he was so burned with chemo and so much pain. And he laughed and giggled and cried, and we all did. And that was my first Make-A-Wish. And they don't usually bring Baby Bop into a lot of the Make-A-Wish because they wanted it to be just them and Barney. But they brought this kid to the set. And then everybody in the whole studio realized how special this was and what we were doing.
So that had to be very, very emotional for
Yes.
you.
Yes, it was very hard, but it was a good thing. You know, we're doing a blessing for this kid. This is his last wish, so.
His last wish to see, that's amazing. I mean.
Well, people, when I tell those stories, and you probably get this reaction too, they'll say, well, that's so sad. I'm like, it's not. It's not. I never saw a child sad when Barney came in the room. Uh-huh. And it did not matter. I've seen things you just absolutely will not believe. I went to a hospital. And I don't know when I'm going in. They don't really tell us. You know, we just kind of have a general idea that we're seeing sick children. And I went into this room, and Carey's gone. So it's Barney. You're jumping and skipping and entertaining. And we don't travel. When we would do the hospitals, there wasn't a voice with us.
That was going to be my question. Okay.
So very rarely. It was usually just us. And I've never had a child say, why is Barney not speaking? Because just seeing him, I think, was, over, you know, once again, a little hospital room, and you've got a 7-foot dinosaur in there moving and wiggling his tail in there. And so we do the thing, and you would just have a moment. So the kid and Barney would go, and I know you would have those too, Jeff. And I was leaving, and the kid said, Barney, I love you. And I was leaving, and I noticed the nurses and the doctor were crying. And so I left, I blew her a kiss, and I went on to the other rooms, and we got out of the costume, and I said, why were the nurses and the doctor was crying? I said, that little girl hasn't spoken in 2 years. These characters made them comfortable. They watched them every day. They trusted them. They loved them. And we never tried to entertain the parents. It was always about the children. And so to have these just unbelievable, he says a blessing. I can't say that enough. Yeah. Can't say that enough.
Remembering these stories, though, how does that make you feel now? You want to get back in those suits?
This fossil, I don't think, could get back in the suit. So
maybe a lot of stretching.
A lot of stretching. I'd be very high maintenance. No, I do it all over again. I mean, but back to just the whole machine of the family that put it together. I do it in a heartbeat. All the people that worked together, it was the greatest job I ever had. And me being little, never discriminated against, never any negativity ever working for that family. And which was really cool. And, I'd go do it in a heartbeat.
So when you were out as yourself, yes, as Jeff, and people said, hey, what do you do? What would you say during those years? Did you say?
I would tell them I worked for Barney and Friends, but I wouldn't really tell them what I did. I kind of kept it quiet because, you know, only for people that were older, because I didn't tell kids that. I didn't want to break the moment, but I'd let parents kind of know.
What about when you were dating?
Yes.
That worked, huh?
Yes.
I'm going out with Baby Bop, yeah. Or Barney.
I actually brought her to the set, yes.
Oh.
Yeah, and I've got another moment to share. I could get long into it, but I'll be very quick.
No, make it good. Come on, I want to hear everything.
I took my wife, girlfriend at the time, to Sleepless in Seattle.
Oh.
And that was one of our first dates. And so, as the story goes, and it kind of, we're a little bit further ahead down the road, I took her to the set, introduced her to the crew, and they got to meet her and stuff like that. And then I got a phone call from the performance director saying, hey, we need somebody to do your stand-ins and a little sing-along while in New York. So you think Kim would do your stand-in work and also your sing-along while you're in New York? And I said, well, you need to ask her. And so they said, of course. And she went up there the week before. We were already up there 2 weeks. And then she came up behind me. And I had this moment. I said, this is the perfect time to propose to her.
Getting hot here. Keep going.
This is the perfect time to propose to her. So, I'll propose to her at the Empire State Building. And this was kind of a mistake because, you know, Barney had about 500 people. or not that many people, but they had a large crew. And so after our wrap party, or after we wrapped the show, we went back to the hotel and took her to the Empire State Building, proposed to her, but went back to the wrap party, and the wrap party was our engagement party, which everybody was there, so we basically had to invite them to our wedding. So, but that's my little love story. That
best date ever. Yeah. Can you top that, Carey?
No, you get you. Come on, you win that one, Jeff.
You're a little red. Come on,
you win that one, Jeff.
But no, and that was it'll be a everlasting, you know, story because that was my family, you know, my other family, and wanted to share the moment with them, and you know, it's a blessing.
Well, and Kim's our family. I mean, it wasn't just us, but it was our families. That it was everyone that.
Yeah.
Became part of that.
Yeah. Which I got to share the moment. So.
Well, Carey's often a little reticent about sharing his moments. What's your favorite Carey story? See, you're red again.
We don't do commercials on this.
No break.
Well, there's a couple of them, you know, like kind of like the meet and greets and stuff where the kids come running up to Barney and all of a sudden they lock legs and put the brakes on, and all of a sudden they see me, so they come to me, and I said, well, I guess we can call it the Baby Bop Show now, you know. And not, you know, but he always said Barney and Friends, not Barney Baby Bop and BJ and Rip. It's Barney and Friends. So, you know, I told him, I said, well, you just got to change the name. It's Baby Bop, you know?
Yeah. And Friends, right?
Yeah, maybe Friends.
So he was a good guy to travel with or yes. kind of work with?
And we, you know, every time we travel, we'd hit the door running, basically. We'd go into a city, try to get there early, and we'd drop our bags off and just make it a day, and then we'd have to go to work. So, and got to travel the world, so blessed. And one of the things was doing the Barney movie, too. I got to go up to Montreal and spend 3 months shooting the Barney movie and having to learn some French.
Un peu le français, monsieur.
I didn't know any French at all. I had to learn how to eat their food, and it was a neat thing. And, you know, that was one of the other blessings that we did. So,
Could Barney work today, given the internet and all the kind of different things now that are competing for children's attention? Of course, Chris told us his grandchild didn't want anything else that was on TV, but wanted Barney.
I think it could. I think 100%. I think it would. And you know, might have to tweak it a little bit, but I think it could.
But you know, the episodes that we did, that I did with Jeff, are back on TV. Just started again on.
They dropped them back out.
So I think once again, because, and I get this all the time, you probably do too. I just, on Sunday, one of my good friends said, "You've got a new fan," and there's a picture of her daughter watching Barney.
It's kind of hard to find it. You know, people go to straight to PBS, but now it's on.
I think it's on Netflix. I think there's several different, and now YouTube.
And now it's here. I mean, we've got Purple Tales podcast. In fact, like anything that's great, everyone wants a reunion. Is that, you think that could ever be a possibility?
We do them, other than just in here. No, we do them, but we're not.
Excuse me. But we haven't done enough of them. Yeah. That's the thing. So.
But not as reunions, but not as your characters. But do you think, if they came to you, that someone comes and said, "Hey guys, we want to do this again. We want to put on a show."
Of course.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's incredible. I mean, I was 23 when I started looking for a job. I mean, I really was. I was a musician always looking for a job. I was a musician looking for a job. And I'd never been in a costume, didn't know really what was involved in all of that. And very quickly, all of a sudden, I started seeing these kids and the reactions, and I had to grow up pretty quickly. Be very responsive when you were doing that. I mean, when he says we did a 20-minute sing-along in a city, well, it was at least three 20-minute sing-alongs.
There's three different
we were doing
shows.
So I guess we'll keep saying back in the day, but we did one at Reunion Arena, which was before American Airlines in Dallas was the arena. And three sold out shows.
It was a tester. It was kind of trying to find out if it was real or not.
Yeah, but you've got 18,000 people coming to see.
And it was only a 20-minute show, and scalpers.
20 minutes.
It was only 20 minutes. It was just a little sing along, not a big, huge.
No
backdrop.
Opening act.
There wasn't.
I mean, just.
It was.
No.
It was a simple.
Minutes.
The original, and then we toured. I toured for 5 years, and that was a full production.
Okay.
It was a simple backdrop, and basically. Our little sing-along for, you know, 20 minutes, and then the big bang at the back end where we did I Love You and melted everybody in the stands, you know, and which was really, really cool.
It's funny, that reunion one, I was just having lots of memories are going to come back. I was having a moment. I invited my family came, and all my high school, I was a cross-country runner, so all my, and they had no idea. I was like, "I'm doing this show. You guys should come." And so I got tickets. They had no idea what it was. And so they're looking at all these people that are in the audience. And then all of a sudden I come
and then
running out on stage.
We did another concert that was at Oklahoma for the Oklahoma City bombing. Mm. And
that incredible.
It was very incredible. It was almost the same type of setup.
And it was a big fundraiser that they did. And the night before, they brought first responders and children that were, so we did a huge meet and greet. And that's important to me. And I noticed to you, Jeff, Barney did so much good. Yes, they sold toys and they did all those things, but they did tons and tons of charity and took us to hospitals and
I think
very important to them.
That was one of the main things. I can't speak for the producers and directors and all that, but I know that we had a big, nonprofit agency for pediatric age, and they were the ones that were getting a lot of the money, so a lot of it was going trying to help, and I know Cheryl was a big advocate of that.
Well, now I know, Carey, you transitioned into becoming a photographer, or you
yes.
were you were always a photographer, still a musician at all? Okay.
A little
here and there. Wait a minute. What do you know about him that he's not saying?
I'm waiting for him to sing.
No, we'll let you do that.
Well, so what are you? How from what you did with the Barney show and as Baby Bop, how has that translated into your grown up life? This life. I mean, are you anything the same thing that you're doing? Or
well, I'm working into mergers and acquisitions right now. selling companies from $1 million all the way up to 100 million, and working for one of the top M&A firms in Dallas, but it's in North America. So,
well, I was gonna say, would you say, I mean, it's sales, because sales. I mean, Barney is in many ways, Barney and Friends, sure, was sales, yeah, wasn't it?
And it's always selling. Yeah. So.
But do you get that heart thing when you, well, maybe when you get a $1 billion MA, you know, you're doing M&A or whatever they call it. Or,
yeah. It's, you know, it's, I would not trade it for the world for my purple and green. Aww. You know, that was, that I'd rather go back to that.
Did they know that you were Baby Bop?
Of course. Okay. I have to keep it quiet though, because everybody flocks to my desk, so.
Isn't that crazy still?
Your secret life?
That's my secret life.
Ooh, that could be, so that's kind of like the underlying, the secret lives, yeah, of you guys.
The secret life.
So, can you sing? Little,
no,
sing us out.
No. He'll sing I Love You for you.
No, he won't.
Maybe it's only with a date.
No, it is absolutely not with a date.
Well, I want to thank you so much for coming. I mean, is there, what do you want us to do in this podcast? You're our first guest. And Oprah said the hardest thing to do is get a first guest. So thank you for being our first.
You're welcome.
What can we?
The only one that agreed to.
Oh, okay. Never mind. Done. We're done.
No, I'll say this very quickly, and this is what's been just. It doesn't feel like any different than when we were doing traveling.
That's.
I mean, we don't have a problem talking. I cannot see him or talk to him for a year.
Yeah.
And there's no.
It's like we saw each other yesterday.
Yes.
But we say some things, and we make them giggle.
Just a little bit.
Yeah.
Well, I want to know what you want us to do on this show on behalf of the entire crew, all the people that made this possible through the years.
Well, I'll tell you, my goal with this is to highlight everyone,
yes,
that was involved in this. From, as he mentioned, he kept mentioning publishing.
It's,
there was a lot of people involved that weren't involved with that. But Jeff and I spent so much time in that. And then obviously the TV show and then special events. Jeff and I did that. I did the tour. There's a whole group of people involved
in
that.
It's not just one thing.
So many people.
So many people involved in this. You know, from publishing to production to roadshow to special events to, you know,
to PR, to the people that did the sales, the people that, I mean, there was a lot of people involved.
A lot of people that made it work. And without all those people, it would not have worked.
Well, we hope to find every single one of them, right?
Because, absolutely.
But I want to preserve these wonderful memories. That's what, I don't think we have those written in stone yet, do we?
No. Nancy, I think it's pretty obvious we're going to have him back.
I hope so. When you're out there, you know, wooing some girl as the one-time Barney, we'll have, oh, and playing the, okay, well, Jeff can be the host. I think that'll work. Look, he's real easy to turn red, isn't he?
Yes.
And I'm sure you have a lot more stories.
I've got the box.
Ah, okay. So how do you want to finish this out, Carey? This is your show.
Oh, I'm so thankful, and it feels so good to be doing this, and having Jeff here is just...
Thank you very much.
It's so special. And what's so great is I'm hearing stories I haven't heard before. As Jeff is telling things, I've known him for 25 years, and I haven't heard some of these things. I didn't know the audition story.
Okay. I guess that's my secret.
Well, not anymore. Not anymore. So you're going to be able to get all these people together, and we're going to talk about all this.
Yeah, it should be a lot of fun.
Okay. Well, thank you for being the first. You'll always be the first guest. And you'll always be the host.
And I guess we need to tell people that they can see this. This will also be visual, that they can see this, because you're missing some things here with Jeff here. that audio just doesn't do.
Yeah, but yours, and they're not. I don't want anyone to miss your sweat. We've
no,
got
no,
him.
No, no, no,
we've
let's,
got
let's
him.
Just the audio for that.
Well, we will be back.
Thank you, ma'am.
We'll surprise someone with our next guest, Jeff, Carey. I'm Nancy. And this has been episode 1 of Purple Tales Podcast. Ooh, that just put chills on me. Thank you.
Thank you.